Well, that's a great statement too, because when I first started my polar exploration, it was really sort of about me, how I wanted to go to the pole, and how my witnessing of this Arctic and Antarctic continents has made me be sort of an advocate and an ambassador for climate change, because that's what I've been seeing. And I've been to both poles more than anybody on the planet, skied to both poles more than anybody on the planet. I've done 12 South Pole trips and 14 North Pole trips, so quite a bit of time on my life. I'm a skier, I live in Lake Tahoe here, not too far away, and I ski probably 200 days a year, so that's a big part of my life. But also, as I'm going on these journeys, I'm also doing some science experiments, which I'll talk about in a little bit. In 2003, I designed what's called the ice bike, and I wanted to go really for my own needs. I wanted to go to Antarctica by myself, and actually I designed this bike that would cruise across the snow, the deep snow, and Time magazine said it was one of the top 30 inventions of 2004, I'm sorry. But I had a sled, had all my necessities for that trip. And Antarctica is the highest, driest, windiest, coldest continent. And so it's a desert. But they actually get, you know, they'll get about 12 inches of precipitation a year. And so that's all they get. So the actual ice is actually growing. And Antarctica is huge, almost the size of the United States. Okay, so it's growing about a foot a year. There are a lot of glaciers especially the Antarctic Peninsula, almost 7 glaciers that are calving at an alarming rate. You hear stories, okay? An iceberg the size of Rhode Island is just calved off the Larsen B ice shelf, the Wilkinson, blah, blah, blah. So you are seeing that. I'm not sure if that's a climate change thing or it's cyclical. And I'll go into a little bit of that. But I did this ice bike expedition. It was awesome. You see me cruising across the ice, but I got hit with an atypical storm. So I'm starting to see these really strange storms as I'm traveling to these remote places. I got hit with 30 inches of snow, 150 mile an hour winds. And I had to crawl. You couldn't even stand up on 150 mile an hour wind. So I had to crawl outside my tent and take my shovel and take the snow off my tent so I didn't get buried alive. So after 5 days, the wind scoured the snow away and I was able to continue the journey. But I also been on Aconcagua, which is the highest peak in South America. And I've seen a lot of this glacier called the Polish Glacier. It's used to be, I went there in 2007 was the first time and we had great snow. So I've been back 3 times since and I'm seeing less and less ice on the glacier. So this is the highest peak in South America, and this is what it looked like in 2009. I've been there one other time since then, and I'm seeing less and less ice. Also, Choyoyu, which is the 6th highest peak in the world. I went there to climb that mountain in 2003, and you can see Everest from the top, but as I'm going to the Himalaya, I'm seeing the glaciers changing, and it's just sort of an alarming for me to actually witness this in the short period of time that I'm actually going there. So I went there in 2003. The people are awesome, like they are indigenous people. They're super strong at high altitude. I went there to snowboard, actually, the highest peak. And I also do high-speed feeds. This is me in Antarctica. You can see the penguins around. Next week, I'm actually leaving on a boat like this and going down to Antarctica from Ushuaia, Argentina. And I have the ability, I've actually pioneered the technology to actually stream video. I can carry that little BGANs. If you look at that pedestal, there's a BGAN Inmarsat connection. And I also have a cup of tea, I think, that in my thermos. But I could set that up to a northern sky and go wireless to my computer and be able to have a Skype call with the classroom or whomever, and we can interact live, and hopefully the wildlife is there where we can interact with it and have people ask me questions. So super cool. Here's me, a Delhi penguin jumps up right for the classroom, which was awesome to be able to have that. And the kids are just screaming and yelling. They can't believe the penguin's right there. And then they can ask us questions live. And here's me in a classroom. I spent this past week just going on the East Coast, up and down the East Coast, doing lectures for students. I also been involved, I'm ambassador for climate change with Mr. Al Gore. and he's a ex-vice president, and I'm part of a I am pro snow campaign, which is I'm an ambassador for, which I'm proud of. And also we're hanging out with a ski racer named Ted Ligety. I've been involved in a bunch of ski movies, but it's really why I'm here, because it's really my observations that I'm seeing that's really helping scientists out, because I'm going places that they've never been to before. My first trip to Antarctica was at the Vincent Massif, which is the highest peak in Antarctica, and same sort of deal. I go there, we went to go climb and ski it, and we got hit with an atypical storm, and I had visions of going there and skiing it on ice and using ice tools, and we had 30 centimeters of snow at Camp 3, and we were skiing Antarctic Pal, which was just awesome. I fell in love with the continent. It was an amazing experience. About 8 months later, I was asked to guide a blind gentleman and a deaf gentleman across Antarctica, which was, I learned a lot about myself. This is Miles Hilton Barber on the left and John Cook on the right. And you certainly have a lot of introspective thought to be out there for 62 days. I had to put my thinking cap on. How am I going to get this guy to the pole? He can't see. The other guy can't hear. I tried a bell on the back of my sled. That didn't work very well. Day one, I looked behind me and he's skiing off into the abyss because the wind was so strong, he couldn't hear the bell. And so I had to unhook my sled and go chase after him. And I ended up just having to ski right next to him. And there's a thing on the snow called sastrugi, and it's caused by wind. And so there's little undulations in the snow. And I tried to really shut my eyes and ski about 100 meters, and I fell over like 30 times. So I really had to give it to him. So what I would do is I would either push him or pull him, and he would be able to ski around that sastrugi so he didn't trip himself up. But it was a great trip. We had high winds. You can see some of the sastrugi in the distance there, and the winds will just be fierce, and you know, you end up having to dig your tent out a little bit. You can see the sastrugi. I think I told Miles to stay there, and I actually went ahead and set up a camera and then went back. But Antarctica is pretty amazing. The trip that I did was, you could see how Antarctica is formed. And this is, there's permanent ice pretty much in this Ross Sea and also the Roney Ice Shelf. That's permanently, but that's where the land actually stops. So almost where the T is, the trip with Miles was pretty much right above me from here all the way to the South Pole. The South Pole is a dome. A lot of people don't realize that it's 9,300 feet on top. And you, of course, we're leaving at sea level. So I've actually done a few trips from the coast. Here's a turn of the century explorer named Ernest Shackleton. In 1909, he got within 76 miles of the South Pole and actually turned around. And so great, great man. In 1914 through 1916, he put together the Imperial Transantarctic Expedition. And you guys should read this book because it's still to this day one of the most heroic stories ever. He came into the Roney Ice Shelf. His boat got crushed by early sea ice that came in. And what happens is that's, just to back up a little bit, that sea ice melting every summer up on the North Pole, the Arctic Ocean melting, is creating that thermohaline circulation. The same thing happens here. The circumference of Antarctica expands almost 500 miles every winter, and now it's going into summer, so it recesses back again. So I don't know if anybody saw March of the Penguins, but they laid the eggs, and the males hibernated the eggs, and then spring came, and they had to travel vast distances to jump in the water. That's really what happened. The sea ice expanded, and they had a huge distance to actually travel. So what happened in Roney Ice Shelf? The boat got crushed. They stayed next to the boat. Finally, a little rowboat. They dropped off all their men on the very last tip of the Antarctic Peninsula, an island called Elephant Island. Shackleton sailed 800 miles to the island of South Georgia, went back to Punta Arenas, Chile, which was 1,700 miles, wrote a letter to the Queen of England, which ended up taking 6 months, and then 6 months for the money to get back, and he went down to rescue his men, and the boat got crushed off of Cape Horn. He went back to Punta Arenas, borrowed a Chilean tugboat that wasn't even suitable for the Antarctic, went down and rescued every one of those men. They lived on penguin and seal for 22 months. Just a pretty amazing story. So what I wanted to do is I wanted to go in sort of where that island is called Burtner Island, and I wanted to do the journey that he intended to do of 1914 through 1916 and ski unsupported from that point all the way to the geographic South Pole. So I did. I didn't go by boat. I went in by a big, huge aircraft called Ilyushin, a Russian aircraft, and landed on an ice runway. And then after that, I took a ski-equipped plane, which is a DC-3 turbo, twin turbine prop plane that dropped me off at my location. And we got dropped off and started the journey. I fell into four different crevasses up to my chest and had to extract myself. But this is a really interesting picture because you can see the undulations in the ice and snow. You were gaining a little bit of distance as you went to the pole, but you also went down and went up. But at the end of the day, you ended up gaining a couple hundred feet. So in the first, I'd say 2 weeks of this trip, we gained almost all the way up to the polar plateau. So from sea level all the way to almost 9,000 feet in the first 2 weeks. So you gradually climb, but some days were more aggressive than others. And this isn't actually mountains behind me. This is actually just crevasses or sea ice. It's only about 60 or 70 feet high. And it's the ice is being pushed. And when it goes over rocks, it creates crevassing and separation. And so there's all kinds of holes around there. You can actually see my tracks that come across and then our tracks in the front. And what I did is did sort of the same thing. I went ahead, set up the camera, and then went back and got in the picture. And you can see I got two pictures on that one. So, but you really have to be organized. You know, it's minus 40, so everything's color-coded. We have fuel to actually melt our ice and snow so we can make water, so we can eat and drink. All my snacks in the front, we stopped every hour and a half to be able to eat enough. I was burning over 10,000 calories a day on these polar journeys. You're only eating about 5,556. And then all the color-coded stuff sacks with headgear, face masks, goggles, extra gloves, that kind of thing. A lot of whiteout conditions, so you have to be creative. How am I going to navigate in a whiteout? When the sun is out, I can use pretty much my shadow. At 2:22 in the afternoon, I know that south is right here and that my shadow is right here. And it slowly moves around, so I can almost be like a clock and know exactly where my shadow is when the sun is out. If you don't have any sun, you have to use a compass and you know, use your compass. And if you look at my ski pole, I have a little, almost a wind flag on there. And I'm able to, even if I can't see my hand or my skis, I can hold that thing up really close to my face and be able to tell what direction that flag is moving. And then actually pull out my compass and be able to determine where we're at. And then at the end of the day, we have GPS. I'm not like Shackleton. You know, he didn't have anything. I have a GPS that I can know how much distance I traveled and where I am and how accurate my my navigation was. But also, we have, you know, I have a little iPhone, and I can hook that up to a Iridium satellite connector, and I can update my Facebook account, my Twitter account, my website, all that kind of stuff. So technology is allowing me, even at the poles, to be able to do all that. But you can see I have tape on my face, and that's really more preventative maintenance. So when I'm sweating, and it's basically an aerobic activity, when you have goggles on, your face will freeze to the goggles. And so when you pull the goggles off, you'll rip a bunch of layers of skin off your nose. So I put that tape there just so I don't do that. And even myself, who's been there more than anybody on the planet, makes mistakes. My goggles froze shut. I end up putting them on my forehead for several hours, and I got what's called snow blindness, and you burn your retina. One of the most painful things, and actually 2 days prior to that, I went to chew on a piece of chocolate and broke a tooth, and I had to pull it out with a needle and those pliers. So in this picture, I have a bunch of gauze where the tooth was. Every time I blinked, it was so painful. I ended up putting a patch on, and then just actually skied for the next 2 or 3 days and arrived at the geographic South Pole. 47 days it took me to get to the pole. It was 737 miles from Burtner Island to the pole. And this is me before the trip, weighing in at 217 pounds, and here I am after, weighing at 174. So you guys heard of the South Beach diet, this is the South Pole diet. And like I said earlier, 10,000 calories a day, I was only eating 5,546. But I had to shave my head, we don't bring a comb or anything. You only bring the exact necessities to survive. I wear the same underwear the whole time. Every week I'll turn it inside out, and then I'll flip it backwards the next 7 days, and then another 7 days I'd turn it inside out the other way. But 2 years ago, I was fortunate enough And I really had to put my thinking cap on this one too. I took a handicapped guy to the South Pole, and he was in a snowmobile accident in the Sonora Mountains of California, and he overshot what's called a gap jump. So he went to go on a snowmobile 150 feet and overshot it and landed, and the doctors said he would never walk again. He broke his L6 and 7. And he got married a month prior, and as his wife states it, I stood by him when he couldn't stand for himself. And this guy wanted to ski to the pole, but we had to design the sit ski so he could traverse across the Antarctic continent. And when you think of skis and you think of snow, you think of glide, okay? There's absolutely no glide because the snow is so cold and the crystals are so large that it would be like pushing that sit ski across this carpet. That's how hard it is. 250,000 push strokes. So I was really quite impressed with his effort to try to get to the South Pole. And you could see the design of the sit ski. We did a bunch of tests in up in Fairbanks, Alaska. We were up there testing them. We went to Spitsbergen, tested the sit ski, and we were always constantly modifying it. So we really had to put our thinking cap. Not only that, but we also, it's not about his disability, it's about his ability. So we had to come up with ways. He can't feel his toes. It would be a disaster if he froze his toes and got frostbite. So what we had to do is put thermocouplers on his toes, run wires all the way up his leg every morning, and then put a little temperature gauge on his stomach. So every hour I could like reach down and look at the gauge and make sure he wasn't freezing his toes. So, and we did make a movie about it. Morgan Freeman is actually the narrator, and it should be out in the spring. So I'll have to let Professor Fields know about it, and hopefully you guys go and see it. It's called The Push. But we're cruising across the Antarctic continent. It was really cool. And the last 100 feet, he wanted to get up. He's trying to do about 120% recovery. So he wanted to get up and get in the skis. And as we're getting to the pole, he's like, we go through the original 12 Antarctic treaty countries, and he's skiing. We're sort of there helping him make sure he doesn't fall over. And he looks over at me and he's crying. He says, I wish my wife was here to see this moment. And we secretly flew his wife in for the event. So, and that was pretty cool because as Grant puts it, Grant's his name, Grant Corrigan, he's sitting there and he said, I had said, I wish my wife was here to see this moment. This person, because at the pole it's minus 40 some degrees and in a big, huge down jacket and goggles and, you know, big hat and you can see a little bit. She pulled her goggles off and walked up to him and said, congratulations, you made it to the South Pole. And Grant really couldn't tell because his eyes were all frozen from sort of crying. And he's like, this woman came up to me and she sort of looked like my wife. And gave me a big kiss and I wasn't sure if I should keep on kissing her or not. But anyway, so last year I was fortunate enough to be involved in an international climate change expedition where we actually came in. You're starting to get to know the lay of the land, and you could see the sea ice that's permanent here, right in the Ross Sea and also the Roney Ice Shelf. Other way, Ross Sea and Roney Ice Shelf. But we flew in on that plane, that ice runway, and we used a 6x6 Toyota Tundra, Toyota Tundra. It's called a Hilux, actually. 6x6, which means there's six wheels, and they're all independent suspension. And we drove it all the way to the South Pole, which was an expedition in itself. And then we drove it down to an area called the Leverett Glacier. And we started at where the coast is. It looked like it was all white where we started, but you could actually see some crevassing. You look in the crevasses, and about 100 feet down, there was some water. So we started at the coast, and we actually gained the first, I think, 5 days of the trip, we gained 9,000 feet. So it was almost immediate ascent right out of there. But it was just a, to even get across the Antarctic continent in the truck was an expedition in itself. That little box in the back, I took a 19-year-old who was doing the experiments, and we partnered with a couple guys that I've also handed off to Dr. Fields. And so we're working with a bunch of different doctors. We were actually, our main concern was collecting snow samples and isotope readings. So we would dig these, we'd do core samples and we'd dig huge pits almost 3 meters deep, which would take 3 or 4 hours of a lot of work and making sure that we had the proper samples. And we would just take a couple samples and they would be frozen in little vials. And then we put them in a Pelican case and we sent them back. So we're still waiting. I'd like to see what the actual data that we collected and find out a little bit more. But we drove across the continent with a truck. This is Parker. He goes to Yale. He didn't get accepted at Stanford. And here's us in the tent. We're just eating a little bit. And just interesting, I took my jacket off one day because it was a little bit warm out. And so this is sweat that's actually penetrating through my shirt and actually freezing the crystals. The salt is just freezing on my shirt. But we ended up doing this 450 miles from basically the Ross Sea to the pole in 18 days and 43 minutes. So the previous record was 24 days. So we pretty much smashed the record. And 18 days is now the new record to get to the geographic South Pole. There's a base there at the pole. And they're doing some great science work there. That's where they're stationed with the international core samples. They're actually doing cores 840 million years ago. And they're able to detect 30,000 years. There'll be a big brown ring in the core sample, and there was a volcanic eruption 30,000 years ago. So they're doing some great science there. They also have some high-powered telescopes, and if I had some more time, I'd be able to tell you a little bit more about some of the science we're doing. We had a film crew with us, so we were doing some filming as well. So, and that's one thing that was sort of interesting about the expedition. We were actually we did the first live streaming. You can see on the truck itself, there was these CCTV cameras. There was several Iridium ports, and we were actually able to do television shows to Weather Channel with Al Roker. We were able to do all kinds of crazy stuff, and we would just ski up to the truck, and then the camera would actually be able to see us, and we'd have to hear with an Iridium satellite phone, hear the questions and be able to talk to our broadcast. But that's another thing within these trips. Usually you get dropped off of the plane and then you're on your own and you don't see anybody until you arrive. And so this was a little bit interesting concept because we had a truck about 100 feet from us. We weren't taking anything from the truck, but it was still right there, you know, and it's all running and it's warm in there. And, you know, so it was a little hard. It didn't really bother me, but I think it bothered Parker a little bit because he could always just sort of bail out at any time and just jump in the truck. So this next week, I'm going to be taking a boat across Antarctica, and we will be doing some isotope readings down there and collection of some data and also some temperature relevance with the water temperature. And I have noticed a big change in the water temperature on the Antarctic Peninsula. I go to this eastern side of the peninsula. That's about 600 miles across the roughest sea in the world called the Drake Passage. I've done 30 crossings, and 30 have been like Drake Lake. And 15 have been Drake Lake, and 15 have been Drake Shake. So we've had some, we're going on a big, huge boat, a 300-foot boat. But here's a picture of some of the Drake Shake. It's about 6 foot tall, that front of that boat from the very top to the floor. So the waves were enormous, and it's not always a good thing. But the ice is constantly calving. When you get to the peninsula, some of those icebergs are just massive. I think that one's about 60 or 70 feet high. And 3/4 of that iceberg is below the water surface. So some of them are grounded, some of them are not. But 3/4 of that is actually below. And just beautiful. I mean, it's really amazing to be able to, I get my paddleboard out and I'll go paddling around the stuff. You can see me paddling. And it's just amazing because you can sort of sneak up on the wildlife too. And because you're non-intrusive, you don't make any noise, you're just sort of paddling and they're like, oh, what's that? You know, they'd never seen a guy on a paddleboard before. And the wildlife is completely insane. This is an Adelie chick. And it'll take about 7 or 8 weeks for the chicks to actually lose all the feathers. Within 3 or 4 weeks, they get to almost the same height as the adults. But they can't go in the water yet until they lose all those feathers. So the mom or dad will actually have to regurgitate the krill. That's what they eat. And I have noticed that there's been differences in the krill populations because of the temperature of the water. So what's happening is big change in water temp, okay? krill populations are moving. These penguin species usually go to the same places to breed, and now they're moving because of the food sources. So we have noticed that. There's all kinds of scientific bases along the peninsula that are doing studies. This is a chinstrap penguin. More chin straps. And this is a Gen 2, but you can see it still has some feathers on it, and it sort of has barbs inside that teeth, and that's for catching that krill, and the krill can't swim out, but they're swimming in the water, and they just sort of open their mouths and through a big school of krill. Here's some Gen 2s, and they will make paths up and down to make their nests, and they grab usually a couple rocks from the beach, and they'll march them up, and it will take, you know, several weeks for them sometimes to build a nest, and they usually like spots, and they'll build it with rocks around, and they go back and forth. And here's a mom regurgitating the krill to a chick. Mom or dad, I'm not sure what sex it is, but still has a few feathers on the neck and before it can go hunt for himself. Here it is again, another chick trying to get some more food. A Weddell seal. Leopard seals, you can see this one's a little beat up. These eat penguins. This is their source of food. And you can see it's sort of a blue environment because that's part of that iceberg that I was telling you about that's 3/4 of it's below the water surface. These are elephant seals, bunch of females just lounging. And here's a big male. And I don't always agree with their dating habits. They have about 30 girlfriends. And then another male will actually approach the rookery or the harem, and then they'll fight. And the winner, and you can see this guy's a little beat up, but I think he won. And the winner, the male winner, will actually retain the harem. So if a new male comes in and wins the battle, the other one has to go out to sea and he'll look for another harem to go to. But the one who wins the battle ends up retaining the harem. And it's amazing to watch too, because there's a bunch of pups that are milking with the mom, and they'll crush them. They'll basically just go straight for the other male. And if they're in the way, then they'll die. I mean, I've seen it happen a couple times. It's pretty crazy. Humpback whales, killer whales. I actually witnessed a pod of 7 killer whales actually work together to kill a seal that was on an iceberg. They try to flush it off with the tails, with big, huge waves. And then what happened is the one just jumped up on the iceberg and pushed it down, and another one had its mouth open and it slid right into the mouth, and then they both, it was just carnage, the rest of it. Killer whale. And then this one sort of came right, I was in one of these little Zodiacs and it came right underneath my Zodiac. And we're there to ski. We do some science work, we do some high-speed feeds, but we're there hanging out, and I found this really cool ice cave with walls over 30 feet tall, and it went over 100 yards long. So it was hollow. Basically, not hollow, but you could go in one end and come out the other. And it had a roof on it from the ice moving, and it also had a floor in it. You could see our ski tracks, but those walls are over 30 feet high. Really cool. And I'm there to ski, so we do some ski descents. And we also do some speed flying and have some fun as well. And we always jump in the water, polar plunge. And the water temp's probably about 33 degrees Fahrenheit, or just right above 1 degree Celsius.
How long can you stay in the water?
Not long. You can get cramps and stuff like that. So in 2005, I wanted to focus on the North Pole. So I went with 2 buddies of mine, a Dutch guy and a Norwegian guy, and we put together an international climate change expedition. I didn't want to just go and beat my chest and go to the pole. I wanted to ask the scientists, what can I do? How can I help you guys out? And we were leaving from Siberia, that whole sea ice model you could see, a place called Cape Artichesky, which was about 600 miles from the pole. And we spent about a month in Russia, in northern Siberia, Hatanga, Krasnoyarsk, just sort of paying off, you know, Russian people, because even though we had all the permits, you still have a lot of bribery to deal with. And but anyway, we wanted to do an international climate change expedition. We said we would do some snow depth measurements, and what they did is they end up handing us these 50-pound beacons, and these beacons track the ice up to 5 years and give the scientists data on temperature, barometric pressure, and location of where that ice was moving. These is really key information for them to figure a lot of this out. other than those NASA models that they saw there. So what they're doing is these beacons were very, very valuable. I weigh every gram. You saw my sled. I wear the same underwear every day, and I'm cutting labels out of clothing. So there's no way that I could even take one of these 50-pound beacons. Our sleds weigh about 300 pounds alone. So what I did is I sort of Mark and I and Petter put our thinking caps on, and we redesigned the beacon, and we made it about 7 pounds. So from 50 pounds to 7 pounds. And not only did we make it lighter, we made it better. All carbon fiber tubing, and then it went like 3 meters in the air. So it was actually more accurate than the ones that they were using anyway, because they were tossing a lot of those out of the plane, and then they would just land, and then they would be good. They would start them just from inside the plane and then toss them. But this is the Arctic Ocean. On day one, we left on March 1st, and pretty much we had about 5 hours of daylight, so it was pretty brutally cold all day long. And then every day up until March 22nd, we got almost 40 more minutes of light. And we got dropped off by helicopter at Cape Artichesky. And here's a picture of, I'm on the left, Mark is in the middle, and Petter's on the right, and he's Norway, Holland, and USA. And here's one of the beacons. And you can see all the instruments down below, and then the more the temperature gauges and barometric pressure gauges are up top. And we made three of them and actually put them on the ice. If you look at our jackets, they're pretty soggy because it is a very humid environment. And here's a picture of us doing some data collection after skiing for 14 hours a day. We would still go out there for an hour and try to get the measurements, so we would do it. It would be sections of 400 meters, so it took quite a long time for us to get the data, and we were making sure that we wanted to get the proper data so we could give that data to the climate change scientists. And we had a standing ovation at a climate change symposium in Oslo, Norway, for the data that we brought back. If you look at our jackets, these are early in the trip, they're full of down feathers and actually kept us warm. By the time 52 days into it, they were pretty soggy. But this is what the Arctic Ocean looks like. It's fairly flat. You see a couple old pressure ridges on the bottom here. That's those delineating lines there. But then the cracks, it's constantly moving through wind and current. And as you saw that model that Dr. Fields showed us, it showed those models where the wind and current was going. And that's why it's such a big ice piece of ice, that it's oscillating and getting smaller, and the pressure ridges can sometimes get to up to 30 feet high, and not only above the ice surface, but also below the ice surface, like a keel on a boat. But a lot of the time, go ahead.
This was not a model. This was actual satellite data. So it's not a theoretician sitting in his office, you know, calculating what the ice looks like. This is actual.
Right.
Yeah, what the bright ice is, what the melt is. But yeah, thank you. The tie-ins are really great.
But this is some fresh ice. And what happens is I think the guy from Barrow was talking, it'll definitely move and then freeze again. So you don't have the multi-year ice anymore. You have fresh new ice. And within a couple hours, it'll freeze solid, especially at minus 40. And you could actually see the salt crystals actually evaporating and freezing. Within a couple hours, we're able to ski across this, you know, and put weight on it. But it's evaporating. And just making beautiful crystals, and we would stop every hour and a half to eat and drink real quick. And just sometimes we have to use masks to cover every piece of skin. You can't have any skin exposed. I think my eyelids were frozen shut on this one. And of course, we ran into polar bears. Usually polar bears go out 150 to 200 miles out to sea, and I think we had a little bit of discussion about that earlier. And they're very interesting mammals. Because what they'll do is they can smell a seal from 8 miles away. They could certainly smell me, because I hadn't showered in probably a couple weeks. The males will actually do a walking slumber. They'll sleepwalk for about 2 months. The females will dig a cave and give birth to 2 to 3 cubs, and the cubs will stay with the mom for 2 to 3 years. But they are really the only mammal that hunts man. And so they're going out on the ice cap, and they're hunting, and they're looking for those open water leads, because that's where the seals are. They actually are in these, they make little holes, air holes, and they have to come up every 22 minutes. And so they'll like just camp out in front of one of those air holes. There's tons of them, but they'll camp out, and when one comes up, they'll smack it on top of the head. But they're starting to adapt. because of climate change. And what they're doing is actually learning how to swim and dive, and sometimes they're actually swimming up to 50 miles. So what's happening is they're going out to the ice cap or on the ice shelf, and then it melts or moves, and then they're having to swim long distance, and they're finding some of the polar bears are actually drowning because it's too far a distance. So, but we had a couple polar bear encounters. I'll tell these little cubs are probably about 2 months old. I'll tell one quick polar bear story. Mark, the Dutch guy, on day two, he was out going to do his morning business. And so I'm in the tent boiling water, and it takes about 2 or 3 hours to boil enough water for the day. So I'm in there, the stove's cranking, making fairly loud noise, and Mark is outside, and I hear a noise. He's gonna kill me, he's gonna kill me. And for me, probably to this monitor, this TV right here, there's a 12 foot tall polar bear on its hind legs. And Mark has a shovel, and he's swinging the shovel, keeping the polar bear at bay with his pants down by his ankles. And so he's going, grab the gun, he's gonna kill me, he's gonna kill me. I grab the gun, I'm not the gun guy. I'm loading the gun, Petter's in his sleeping bag. And he jumped out, and it's minus 50. He grabbed the metal gun barrel with no gloves and ripped about 10 layers of skin off his hands. So Mark is screaming, Petter's screaming, I'm screaming. He ends up jumping outside the tent and shooting the gun in the air and scaring the bear away. And we would have to do rock, paper, scissors to who would sleep in the middle. I didn't sleep for about 10 nights. The very next night, there was one that that got into my sled and was eating food, and it was as close as I am to that that chair, and I took a flare gun out and just hit him square between the eyes. So they weren't, it was something that I had some issues with if we weren't doing our climate change. This is what they eat, bearded seals. But this is a picture, actually, of a lot of the multi-year ice, and this is really what's happening. If you look that picture of the sea ice, you saw toward Canada and Greenland, it was all being pushed down that way. And this is what's happened, okay? And all this multi-year ice is being pushed to the Baffin Straits, okay? And it's not really where up in Siberia, that Siberia is a huge amount of landmass. If you saw that picture of that map, I mean, if you saw it was probably almost half the whole map, it was all of Siberia. So the ice is moving away from Siberia and actually being pushed here. So this is what it takes for us to get through this. It would take us probably several weeks to even go a couple miles. So lots of work, a lot of disturbed ice. We were using two sleds, so we'd have to take a sled and then come back, and then so a lot of pairing. But you can see this is what it looks like in Canada and also in Greenland. And this is up on the Arctic Ocean. We ran into some of this too, but it was a little bit further after probably about 2 or 3 days. For the first 2 days of that trip, we couldn't stop because the ice was so thin. This is back in 2005. So the ice was so thin I was afraid to even stop because I thought we'd fall through. So we had to continue for 2 days straight. And here's some of the pressure ridges that we'll find, and you really have to be careful because you're not only pulling the 300-pound sled up, but also it could slide down and hit you in the ankle or whatever, so you had to be really careful. And you work together as a team. We always work together, and this is what it's like. You pretty much jump from one lily pad to the other and continue, and we jump. And the sleds float. We designed the sleds in Holland, and they would float. And the fabric on top was like a Kevlar fabric. I couldn't cut it with a knife or a ski pole, but the polar bear ripped through it like it was tissue paper. And we would swim a lot of the leads. We'd probably swim about 10 to 12 leads a day. And what we're trying to do is we're trying to go north. So if a big open water section is right in front of us, we would make a decision and just throw on the dry suit and just swim across. I was always skeptical of this because the polar bears are really good swimmers, and one of us wasn't going to have the gun. It was going to be on the sled. So I was like, oh my gosh, we don't have a gun, and polar bear could pop up at any time. And I've even drug a kayak with us because I'm seeing big differences in what's going on up there. So I drug a kayak behind my sled, and it was the way that I got to the North Pole because I was able to cross some of these open water leads in the kayak. And our typical camp and 14 expeditions in the North Pole. And this is Spitsbergen, and I do a lot of paddling there, and I'm seeing differences there. I've actually was there 3 years ago, and they, when I first started doing ski trips there, I was concerned that the ice conditions were going to be too invading, and I wouldn't be able to get back and do skiing. So in the last 6 years, that hasn't been an issue. It's been ice-free. Svalbard has been completely ice-free. So I was worried that I wouldn't be able to go skiing for the first couple years that I was chartering the boat. And now it's not even an issue. I can actually charter the boat almost a month before I was even concerned about it 6 years ago. So I'm seeing big differences up there. It actually rained in January, not only in Svalbard or Spitsbergen, but also in Greenland. And I've been doing trips there as well. Greenland is a place that I'm very, very fond of. I do some ski touring trips there and also filmed the TV show in Ilulissat there just this summer. I was there for 2.5 months filming a TV show and we were looking for gold. And it's the same place where James Balog, I don't know if everyone saw the movie Chasing Ice. It's where the ice the size of Manhattan caved off and they caught it on camera. This is the glacier that I was at. And here's our crew. We had guys from Arizona, Colorado, San Diego, Philadelphia, and that's Nunu, meaning little one. That's our husky dog that was there. And the glaciers in the background, we would just be having to cross that, and we were looking for gold. So we would prospect for gold, rubies and diamonds, and the show will be out in February. We rappelled into ice caves. We actually found gold at the bottom of this ice cave. This is actually the glacier moving, and I rappelled down into this ice cave and was taking samples. And the geologist is with me. We did a bunch of rope work to try to get samples, and we're just flying over it. But that's what the glaciation looks like, and how there's cracks in it is what's happening. It's constantly moving fairly fast, and it'll be going over rock. And what's really happened is 80% of Greenland is ice, and a lot of the time you'll have these lakes that are forming on the glacier, and that's called a moulin. And what happens is, when there's water on the glacier, it heats up because it's getting the sunlight. It heats up and it dives deep. It melts all the way down to the bedrock and then it goes this way. So what's happening is huge, huge miles and miles of glaciation are basically cracking and then just going all out to sea. So they're finding huge sections of ice being just calving at an alarming rate. And that's what they're really scared about is this this cycle that's happening is just escalating and moving so fast. How do we prepare for this? You know, because the ice is just melting so quickly.
So 2 years ago, the news was that for a 2 week period, there was 97% of Greenland had meltwater on it. What's it been like since?
Well, I noticed a lot this summer. I don't have any data to be able to answer that, but it was quite warm. And started to see quite a lot of those moulins. And I did witness a few calving scenarios as well. So it's definitely happening. And Mr. Balog was up there filming again this year too. So he's more working with a scientist, obviously, and you know, he's filming for a reason, so. And I also do some trips to the Amazon, and they're having climate change in the Amazon as well. This is the Brazilian Amazon, and I'm there. And what happens is the rivers rise over 45 feet. And so 3 years ago, they had a huge, huge, not a drought, but what they did is it rose over 65 feet. And then 2 years later, they had a drought, and it only rose like 20 feet. So you're having these huge discrepancies of how high the river rises. And there's over 4,000 miles of river, and everybody goes by the river, so it's really, really important. All the wildlife is affected, because if there's less water, there's not as much room for the fish to go to. There's upper lakes that animals are stuck at, and they don't get to travel as much. So there's all kinds of things that are happening that I'm seeing even in the Amazon, and not just the cold environment, but we're really seeing, I think the Arctic Ocean is truly an early warning sign for us to try to do something about it. And we fish, we live sustainably, piranha, we swim in the water, sloth, giant river turtles, red-faced monkeys, caiman, which are alligators, freshwater dolphins, sloth, And this is their indigenous tribes. And they're the ones who I asked a lot of the questions. I said, you know, how is the climate, you know, how is the water affected, you know, your crops, all these kind of things. So these are the ones where I'm getting my information. But their pet is like a pet sloth. You got a pet dog or cat at home, they have a sloth. And really cool, the Rio Branco is sort of a brown river. And the Rio Negro is the river that I'm on, and it's the Black River, and you can almost see this one's like almost a copper color, and the pH balance is really, really low. And we do night paddling as well, and it's just an amazing place to go paddle and just hang out, and they're naturals. I mean, the indigenous people are just great. Lots of fun. So I want to thank you guys very much. Hopefully you learned a little bit. I try to put my engineering cap on all the time when I want to be more efficient. Want to invent new things. It's not like you go to REI and you go and pick up some of this stuff. So I work with a lot of gear companies, developing tents, sleeping bags, clothing, but it's more for my activity. It's more an aerobic activity, a lot of body mapping, which is a lot of the stuff I have that's very, you know, can move the moisture away from the body in this area, but it's also wants you to protect here when it's snowing and raining and precipitating. So I'm an engineer of sorts, not quite like you guys, but I'm constantly trying to innovate and make myself more efficient. Sometimes I don't get it right. I actually designed a stove that was way too efficient, and I really loved the ambient heat that was coming off the stove in minus 30. And you know, after one day, it was like, oh my gosh, I'm getting really cold in my tent. It was very efficient, but it wasn't something that I wanted. I wanted that ambient heat, so I got rid of the stove that I made, and it was actually a 5-gallon drum, and I had, you know, air holes at the bottom, and it was had a pot that went in it. Almost like Nansen was a turn of the century explorer. He had a double line pot, and I got the idea from him 100 years ago. So they should come out with some of the stuff that they came up with 100 years ago. But I'm constantly innovating and exploring and trying to innovate new things to make my job easier, faster, and also be able to go in these remote places, in some of the most inhospitable places on the planet. And I'm a big climate change advocate and ambassador, and certainly would love to do something about it. And I try to do, we all are at the stage in our lives where, in our communities, where we're doing, you know, renew, recycle, all the, you know, carpool, all the certain things. But, you know, the biggest thing is really trying to curb the carbon offset, you know, and our government is one of the biggest contributors to that, you know, and a tax on carbon. And I think that's a big step that we all need to sort of take an advantage of, because I see that that's one of the biggest problems. So thank you guys very much. Hope you guys learned something. And also, I'm here to answer some questions if you guys have any questions as well.
Pretty stunning journeys, huh?
Yeah.
I was surprised by how high the water level has changed in the Amazon.
Yeah, well, it's just been in the last 10 years they've been having huge discrepancies. On a normal year, it's like 35
feet. But one year it was 65 feet and they had floods everywhere. And then another year it was 20 feet. So
is that torrential rain? Is that what?
Well, it's a rainforest, so it's constantly raining, but it's just the amount of moisture that's coming out, you know? And I think a lot of, you know, that happens, it starts in the Arctic and the Antarctic too, so.
That's amazing. Good questions.
You touched upon this just sort of throughout your presentation, but I'm just curious if you could address directly how, like, what are some of the adaptation measures that communities have taken?
Well, I think I mentioned a little bit. I think the biggest way that I see other countries doing it, well, the Kyoto Protocol happened and was supposed to happen by 2012. A lot of those countries did, and they're seeing huge differences already. Wind farms, solar panels, you know, mainly like Holland and Germany and some of the European countries that actually jumped on that. I'm also seeing one of the biggest polluters, like China, they're jumping in on it too. They're one of the biggest moving forward with solar and wind because they see there's money in it. You know, so they're jumping on it. I'm not sure, I think we're doing our little part. You know, I think California is a little bit more progressive than the rest of the country. You know, I think that's a start. I think, I think I mentioned it, I think we really have to have a tax on carbon, and that then those companies that are really polluting will actually have to do something about it, or they'll have to pull out their paycheck, you know?
Maybe I need to be more specific, but like the community that you work with in the polls, like in Barrow, for example, like what is the effect there? Because that's something I've never had any kind of like exposure or connection to. That's why I'm curious.
Well, that's where it really started. I wanted to go and actually talk to the scientists, and I do because I come to schools and I want to talk intelligently about what's really happening. Barrow's no different than the other places I go to. I think 7 degrees in the last 4 years. Is it 2 years?
It's pretty astonishing.
Yeah, I mean, it's gone. The average temperature has gone up 7 degrees. So we're seeing that world. You know, the whole Arctic is dealing with that.
There is a lot of impact on permafrost melt, and so their buildings are getting destabilized.
Yep.
And so that was a lot of the contractors I met up there were coming up with innovative ways to try to, I mean, think of this in the Arctic, trying to cool the underside of the buildings so that it wouldn't be all melting out.
Yeah, on my trip to Siberia, I was in a place called Hatanga where there's the Dolgan Indians, which are pretty much travel by reindeer and sleds, mm-hmm. and they travel across the permafrost and really happy people and really nice people. But what was really happening was, and what was going on is they were finding woolly mammoth tusks, all kinds of saber-toothed tiger tusks, all kinds of bones and stuff like that. And what was really going on was because, say, a woolly mammoth 30,000 years ago, Pleistocene era, was cruising across a frozen lake, earthquake happened, he breaks through, gets covered up, and basically frozen in time. And then 30,000 years, we're cruising across with Dolgan Indians and stuff. The permafrost is going away, and we're seeing part of this woolly mammoth that's sticking out, okay, because of the melt. And, you know, my idea was probably go with them for a month and find these places and maybe GPS them and go back with the Carnegie Museum of Natural History, unearth the thing, and bring it back. But we're definitely seeing a lot of climate change going on, especially in the permafrost and the CO2 emissions from that. And I was actually in this, they called it a museum. No one goes there. There's only like 500 people that live there. And it's very, you know, people are all depressed because it's all dark all year long, or most of the year. I mean, most of the winter, it's all dark. And I went into this this museum of some sort, and there was basically a frozen block of a woolly mammoth, and a Japanese guy with a hairdryer was in there pulling out live fur from this frozen carcass. Wow. And wanted to artificial inseminate it in a modern day elephant and make a mammoth hybrid. You know, I'm not sure about all this. You know, why did they become extinct in the first place? You know, is it some plague? And, you know, reintroduce it to us and another Ebola thing happening or whatever. But anyway, it was pretty, you know, I was like, oh, yeah, right. You're going to artificial, you know, find this DNA from 30,000 years ago and artificial inseminate in a modern day elephant. So a lot of weird stuff going on. I leave for Antarctica in 10 days. And I take 100 on that big boat and take 120 skiers down there. And we'll do a little bit of climate change studies, just some sampling, some snow samples and some water temperature samples. And we'll also probably stop at a couple science bases as well. But we're there to ski. I have like 120 people I take. So I'll do that. I do have a handicapped guy I'm taking to the pole next year. I also will be back in Greenland this summer and hope to do some science work up there as well. And, you know, I'm also trying to help out 911 too, ICE 911, and see if we can deploy it in a truly Arctic environment, you know, like Svalbard, or even I go to the North, I'll be in the North Pole in April as well. And so that's really where we need to do the science, where it's actually happening and trying to make a difference. The only problem is going to a place where there's a Arctic community that'd be able to check the data. You know, we put it on the Arctic Ocean, I'm there for a month, maybe, and then I go away, and how do we monitor it? Yep.
That's the dilemma. So
yeah.
That's part
and it's
of
constantly
where
moving.
Barrow
the Arctic Ocean's
gets
moving,
exciting.
You know,
yeah.
So.
Yeah. Yeah, this has been, Doug has made many just wonderful connections for us over time, too. It's been fantastic.
Well, it's definitely been fun for me too. I mean, yeah. I love talking to the scientists. They're just really great people, and they, you know, super knowledgeable. And you know, Christian Haas, University of Ottawa, and University of Washington. I mean, they're doing some great work.
They really are. Know. Yep. Any last questions? Not often you get to meet somebody like this. Doug, thank you. Thanks
well,
again.
I'm not an engineer. I like engineering and certainly like to develop new things and certainly have to put your thinking cap on to try to build some of these things that I do to be where I go. And it's been fun. It's always a nice task to see because you really can't get it wrong. I mean, it's important, especially when you're dealing with people's lives and, you know, especially the handicapped people and that kind of thing. But it's not their disability. It's more about their ability. And I really like that. And most of my clients that I take on my polar journeys, I make them raise money for charity or I won't take them. And that's been fun, too. I didn't start out that way. But as I'm going, I have nothing to prove. I don't need to go to the pole. But if you raise money, I feel good about it, too, if that makes any sense. Mm-hmm. So. Thank you, guys. Hope you learned a little bit today.
Very good. Thank you.
On a Friday afternoon.
Yeah. It was worth it, right?